And afterwards, she said, "No, Norm, that's not your time." And she gave me a big hug. And she said, "No, Norm, that's not your time." But she remembered that. That's, it wasn't your time.
So if I was to show you a picture of the hijackers here, there's, do any of those look familiar?
That guy right there.
Okay. Ada.
Ada.
From American Airlines, number 11. What was it about him that you remember?
I don't know. Oh man, I'm too small.
Yeah, let me get it a little bit in zoom here. And you can scroll down.
Let me come in there and sit down in our
I got my glasses. Remember this guy? This guy here. That was one of the guys I saw in Taipei. This guy, and this guy.
So, Ada, from Flight 11, American Airlines, Flight 11.
Right, American Airlines.
And then, I can't believe you that, Nuwaf.
Yeah.
Al-Hazras.
Al-Hazras.
American Airlines number 77, and right. Then Al has no.
American Airlines, that's right. That's the one I was on. I was supposed to be on. That was going from Boston to I think L.A. or San Francisco. I forget which now, exactly. But him, I remember seeing his face in Boston.
And
but he wasn't. He was in Taipei. He was not in Taipei.
So, but Ada wasn't in, you saw him in Boston, but he wasn't of the three that you saw in Taipei.
No.
So the three that you saw in Taipei was on American Airlines number 77, which was, looks like Narwaf, I can't read it, it's kind of
Yeah, Narwaf, yeah, okay, this guy here, and this guy here.
Al-Hazras.
And
Al-Haznawi from Flight 93.
The other guy, but I can't remember now. What did I say it was? Maybe it was this guy.
Al-Mahidar.
Al-Mahidar. 1, 2, 3. That's a long ago now.
Yeah. But you did report it all times that you saw him. And did you report it to any American? Like, after you seen him, before you boarded your flight, you didn't talk to anybody in America? Now, the Commons, is that where everybody gets together around the airport area?
Mm-hmm.
So you saw him there?
You mean the Commons?
Yeah.
No, the Commons is downtown Boston.
Okay.
It's a big park. It's a very famous park.
Okay.
And if you walk to the park, up to the hill, they call it the Beacon Hill, is the State House, the Capitol. In that area, yeah, I'm pulling now. I'm here at Park Street, at the subway station. It's a major subway station, they call it Park Street, in downtown. And if you look this way, you go up, and you'll see the State Capitol and Beacon Hill. The Beacon Hill is the original Boston, going back to the early 1600s. So the people that, some of the people that live there can trace their family to the houses they live in as the first houses in Boston.
Huh. Interesting.
But I remember these guys. And that guy there, I'll remember.
But you were scheduled on American Airlines number 11, from what you could remember.
Yeah, not United, but American. I took. They put me on United.
There's another line of people. American Airlines number 175.
No,
I'm showing you. We didn't scroll down far enough. There's American Airlines 175 too, who had these people
right.
On it. So. Well, very interesting. I guess, did you ever question? go back and want to question why it is they approached you 5 months prior to 9/11, and then they're allegedly the hijackers of a huge terror attack.
I talked to this guy at school, and you know, I said, it's kind of strange, you know. I mean, I saw them one day, I've never seen them again. I asked them, well, why are they there? Well, we're on business, you know. Well, okay, and
you asked them?
I asked them, why are they here in Taipei?
Oh, okay, and they said.
And they said, well, ask me why I'm in Taipei. I said, well, I live here. I said, I live and work here. I said, I teach English. Well, you're an English teacher. Yes, I'm an English teacher. And I said, my home is America. You know, my home. Where? I said, well, my home is Boston originally. But I said that before I came here, I was living in the middle of America. And they were interested about America. You know, they started asking me about America. And I said, well, I lived in Iowa. I said, I lived there for a number of years. I worked there, and I got hurt, and then I decided to go back to school, and I went to one of the top three schools in Iowa to get my degree. And then I said, I just graduated, you know, a couple years ago, and I'm here in Taiwan. And well, they asked me why Taiwan. I said, well, because I like it. I want to learn more about Chinese, you know, and I want to come here first. And then I said, my goal is to stay here for a couple of years, learn more Chinese, and then maybe go on to the mainland and work in mainland China. Yeah. But I didn't tell them I was going to go back to Boston. I remember that.
You didn't?
No. I remember one asked me, well, how often do I go home? I go, well, you know, the last time I was home was in 1985. I said, I went from Boston, I went from Des Moines to Boston. And I came out home to visit my mom. I said, at that time, it was Thanksgiving. And I was very unhappy because I couldn't get back to Des Moines. Why? Because they had a big snowstorm. I said the airports were closed, and the flights were canceled or delayed. I said my flight from Boston, I had to go to Minneapolis, St. Paul, and then fly from Minneapolis, St. Paul to Des Moines. I said my flight was delayed 6 hours because of the storm. Excuse me. I said I was very upset. But that was the last time I was home. And I said, I don't know when I'll get home. Well, don't you miss your family? No.
Really, they questioned you like that.
Yeah, I asked, do you miss your family? Well, yeah, sometimes we miss our family, but we travel a lot. And, you know, when we go home, we're happy. I go, well, yeah, that's true. If I go home, I might be happy. But I said, we didn't have a happy childhood. Okay. And that was it.
And then they just left, or you left?
I said, well, look, sir, I said, it's getting real late. I said, and I have an early morning class, and the school's going to close pretty soon. So I said, I don't live very far from here, so I'm going to go home. And I thought maybe they'd try to follow me, but they didn't follow me. They went in another direction. And
Was there anybody else on that flight that was from China?
Pardon me?
Was there anybody else on that flight that you knew of that was heading back to China?
No, I don't question that when I'm there. No. Somebody asked me on the 8th when I left Boston to San Francisco, the guy, I remember one guy, he asked me where I was going. And I said, well, I'm going to San Francisco. Well, I am too. I said, I'm going to go see a couple of friends I know from Taipei. And then a couple of days later, I'm going to go from San Fran to back to Taipei. And we got talking, and he asked me why. And I told him because I teach over there. And I think I sparked his interest. And I never heard of this before. You know, yeah, people, you know, from, you know, they graduate, you know, they might go, you know, to Taiwan, Japan, or, you know, any of the foreign countries in Asia to teach for a year, 2 years, 3 years, or whatever. And I said, I've been there for several years. I said, I've been there since 92. Which is 2001. Wow, he said, that's really, you like it that much? I remember this, and I go, yes, I do, sir. I like it very much. Okay, no problem. And, you know, have a good time there. He asked if I liked Taipei. I go, well, you know, Taipei is a nice city, but it's crowded, dirty. Expensive at times, but you learn, you know, where to go to eat, and you learn how to, where to go to shop, and it's not so expensive. And you'd be like a native. Okay, and
are you aware that some researchers think that some of the 9/11 hijackers are still alive?
I never heard of that one.
I was just curious, but you think maybe they just wanted the passport because of fraud? Like what kind of fraud? Like financial fraud or identity theft or?
That I really don't know. I never put much thought into that.
What do you think would have happened if you would have sold your passport?
I would have reported it stolen, and then of course I would have got a replacement. I don't know what would happen if they tried to pass off as an American with my name and my date of birth, and these guys are young. I'm a little bit older.
Right.
So I have no idea what they want to do with.
Listen.
What we're really how can I put it now? What really surprises me that these people at AIT show no interest. Of course, that was, you know, what could they do? You know, I mean, this is before this happened. So the security wasn't like it is now.
Right. But you think they would at least file a report. But you're saying that you don't remember writing anything down or saying, we'll give you a call later if we find out anything.
They asked me my name. I told them my name. I told them that I live here in Taipei. And that's it. Didn't even ask me where I worked. Or see my passport, my visas. They never asked me none of that.
Interesting. Very interesting testimony.
That passport I don't have anymore. I wish I still had it. But I left it with my sister in Boston. In 2002, because I had a new one, and the other one expired, and she wanted to keep it for safekeeping.
She did.
She kept a lot of things I had, and I'm trying to. I want to get it back, but I can't get a hold of her. I don't know where she is. And my other sister won't talk to me. So.
Hmm.
That's
So you don't have any way, you have the testimony, but you have no way to prove it.
Yeah.
I suppose if you had to have been on the rosters for the booking of the flights.
I think what they do is they keep the people's names that took the flight, and that's it. If they cancel the flight, they won't keep it. That's what I was told once.
Really?
I was told once if you cancel the flight and you change your flight, your name's not on it anymore. And they don't keep it for a long time. They don't keep it at all.
Interesting. I'm not sure about that. I really don't know the answer on that one.
I don't know either. My students ask me about this, and I told my students, this is what I told you. And I've had some girls come up, but give me a hug and give me a kiss on the cheek and say, I'm glad you're here.
And, well, yeah, I mean, you were booked on the flight that crashed, allegedly.
Right, but I wasn't on that flight, I was on another flight.
Right, but you were originally scheduled to be on the flight, but then you changed it at the last minute.
I changed it a couple days before.
And then you flew to San Francisco instead, which you were scheduled to go to San Francisco, or to Boston, to L.A.
L.A.
But you changed it to Boston, to San Francisco, 2 days before 9/11.
3 days.
3 days, so on the 8th?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that's what I wrote down, the 8th.
Spent 2 days in San Fran.
Well,
I had a good time. I remember that time. She was very happy to see me. And then when I got back, I sent her an email that I'm safe. And she figured that okay. I can't remember exactly what she said, but a lot of things happened here.
Right.
And
the only thing I don't understand is, okay, you left on the 10th.
From San Fran.
So your ticket actually said the 10th, right? So you would
board, originally, yes.
Originally from San Francisco, or explain
LA
that.
LA to Taipei.
Okay, LA to Taipei. You were supposed to board not on 9/11, but 9/11.
Well, 9/11. I was supposed to go on 9/11. Then I would arrive on 9/12.
Okay, because there's a 12-hour.
Yeah, it's different, more than 12 hours. So. But I was to arrive on 9/12.
But then you changed it, and you ended up leaving when?
On the 8th to the 10th.
So the 8th, you left Boston.
Right.
Flew to
San Fran.
And then on the 10th,
I left San Fran to
Taipei. And you arrived in Taipei at 8 o'clock at night.
I believe 8 o'clock at night. I forget what time it was.
Something like that. It was late in the evening, though.
Yeah, because I remember I was home, and I wanted to take a shower, and I knew I had a class in the morning. And,
so you arrived back in Taipei approximately
the time when
a couple hours early, and at least an hour before the attacks happened.
Right.
Okay, so you were in Taipei unpacking, and then you heard the news.
Yeah.
The first plane hit the tower.
Yeah.
Okay, I got it.
That's really. I think I said, holy shit, what the hell is going on? How can this happen?
Well, and the strange thing is, I mean, how can all these passports fly out of a huge fireball? I mean, travel down hundreds of feet and be in perfect tack and be, you know, among the things that the FBI finds right away.
I don't trust the FBI. To be honest with you, I don't trust them.
You don't?
No.
Is there something that happened?
I just don't, and then, well, you know, this is where they are, you know, where they act, look how they act, you know. It's changed a lot, you know. Maybe I could, you know, if I really have to talk to them, well, yeah, fine. No problem.
That is quite the story.
Yeah, isn't it interesting, huh?
It is interesting, and if I have any other questions, too, I mean, I definitely would like to ask you, but...
Go ahead.
The testimony itself is striking, but my question would be, you know, what would they want with an American citizen's passport? I mean...
Customs office in America.
To get in and out of the countries, you mean?
Or to get another country, or maybe to get... Who knows what they want to get?
Sure.
I'm a naturalized American, you know. This is all new America.
Do you remember what they were dressed like when they were in Taipei?
I guess clothes like we wear here. Nothing out of the ordinary.
Like jeans and t-shirts?
Yeah. Pants.
Yeah.
Slippers.
Slippers?
Yeah, you know, sandals. Okay.
What were they?
We used to call them Jesus beats. As kids, we used to call them Jesus beats. I think you did too, right?
Probably. I don't remember that term, but...
I remember that quite really good that time.
Do you remember what they were wearing when you allegedly saw them in Boston?
Maybe the same thing, a shirt and jeans.
So casual clothing.
Casual clothes. But I already kicked myself in the butt because cops, the transit cops, subway cop, they're actually called transit police. I talked to one before, a couple of times. I needed some information on that. I remember talking to him, and he asked me where I was from, and I told him, he asked me, any problems? I go, no, I'm no problems. Okay, well, if there's any problems, let us know. We're around. I says, well, my brother's a trooper, I might call him, and he asked me if I could tell him his name, and I told him, I think I know who he is. I said he works for the Special Services Unit. So I said he was okay. He knew that what I was talking about. We see the guys around a lot.
Special Services Unit.
Yeah, that's what it was called, the Special Services Unit.
What is it?
Well, they do special services.
For the military?
No, they go after drug dealers.
Oh, like a task force?
Yeah, drugs, guns, bombs.
In the United States. You're talking about your brother in the United States.
Yeah,
my brother
in the United States, yeah. For the Massachusetts State Police.
Oh.
I saw him at that time, maybe an hour and a half. And then I saw him again when I was back in 2002 and 2004.
Did you ever tell your brother about this?
I did in 2004 when I was away from my sister. I met him and two of the guys he worked with. We spent an afternoon. And I remember talking to him about it, okay, thank you very much, very interesting, there's over, nothing we can do. He says, I have nothing we can do now, it's...
Yeah.
I go,
Well, Norm, thank you.
You're welcome.
And for the record, will you state your name for me?
Norman Blaisdell.
And today is August 31st, 2012.
Right.
So exactly 11 years ago.
11 years ago.
You left Taipei to go to Boston.
Just about, yes. Exactly.
All right, well, good. And if there's any more questions, I'll ask you in future.
What?